good afternoon. Welcome to our session. This is such an important topic, particularly at this point in the beginning of the fourth industrial revolution, where technology is really center stage. So Jonathan, I wanted to direct the first question at you. How can technology help to close the gender divide?
Thanks for that question. But before I get into the substance of it, I think it's worth reflecting on why the question is important in the first place. I was speaking at a panel on the SDGs yesterday about the fifth goal, gender equality. Mm-hmm. And I felt as if I should have been talking about all of them, because gender equality is essential if we're going to achieve absolutely any of the other goals. At Girl Effect, an organization founded by Nike almost 15 years ago, we believe that girls are the key to changing the world. Girls are the key to achieving gender equality. And what does technology have to do with it? Well, working in partnership with organizations like Vodafone, Unilever, Facebook, we are using technology to provide girls with the information, the inspiration, and the access to the tools and resources they need to change not just their own lives, but the lives of their families and their communities. And that means different things in different places. In South Africa, it means providing girls with access to a chatbot that's on hand to answer their urgent and embarrassing questions about sex and their bodies. In India, it means producing a sketch comedy web series that helps girls understand how they can negotiate for decision-making power with their boyfriends and their families. And in Tanzania, it means giving people access to an interactive voice response line that provides them with inspiration and tips from entrepreneurs to help girls access economic opportunity.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So Sebastian, can you talk about how technology can actually get more people online? And what role do smartphones or feature phones actually play in that?
Yes, sure. So first of all, when we talk about digital divide, actually many people still think that the main problem is the infrastructure, the lack of infrastructure, not having a network, data capable network covering you. The reality is, if you look at today, the 4 billion people who are not connected to internet, only a portion of that, probably around 750 million of people are not covered by a digital network. The rest of the population, they don't access to internet because of the cost of the device, because of the cost of data, but also because of education and because of the lack of digital literacy, we'll say, and or relevant content. So it's not only technology. Of course, technology is important. We work on the technology and the cost of the device and the cost of data, but we also partner with Girl Effect, for example, and with some other partner to work on education, to make sure that people understand the benefit of the technology and what internet can bring to them. So I wanted to insist on that. The technology is not the only problem. There's also education, literacy education, that is important in closing digital divide.
And culture, right? To some extent, culture.
Yes.
Can you say the number again? So yeah, how many so people are not on, because I think that
you have
I want to make sure everybody gets that. It's a big number.
Yeah, roughly 4 billion of
4 billion.
People who are not connected.
Who are not connected.
Of which 750 are not connected because of the lack of network.
Because of the
lack of coverage.
Yeah. Yes. 4 billion.
Yeah.
All right. Well, Maya, can you tell us from an investor's perspective what is exciting about what's happening in Africa, and how can investors really work to actually close this digital divide to ensure that 4 billion people get online?
Yeah. So, and just as context, so I run a $10 million early stage venture fund focused on investing across sub-Saharan Africa. And so to put it in a little bit of context, as far as on the continent where emerging trends are happening. So on the consumer side, you have 1.2 billion people on the continent, 93% mobile penetration. There are now more mobile users in Africa than the US and UK combined. And we have rates across the continent ranging from as low as about 20% to upwards of 50, 60% of internet penetration. Of that 1.2 billion people, about 75% of them are under the age of 35, and about 41% of them are under the age of 15. So you have a very young population. You have a very tech-enabled, so everyone has mobile devices, and increasing rates of internet penetration as well. On the continent, you also have three, sometimes four, depending on the year, of the 10 fastest-growing economies, as well as the fastest-growing consumer classes. Next year, we're projected to be at about $2.2 trillion in consumer spending. So really fast rates of growth as far as the middle class, the consumer spending, and then young people at large. So the sectors that are most impacted by this are financial technology. So I'm sure everyone in the audience has heard of companies like M-Pesa. It's now transacting about 1/4 of Kenya's GDP. Or Paystack, one of our portfolio companies that was backed by Stripe, Visa, and Tencent. We're having actually a lot of Chinese and or Asian and American and European investment funds actually shifting their strategies now to focus on investing across sub-Saharan Africa. And there's a lot of activity in the financial technology space. Though currently there's only about 25% of Africans even have bank accounts. So there's still an incredible opportunity. There's still so much inefficiency in cross-border and remittance and payments. So the fintech space at large, it's oversaturated, but there's still a lot of infrastructural problems in key markets across the continent. The other side of that is mobility. That could be people like busing systems, Swivel, they just raised about $30 million, or Kobo 360, they just raised about $30 million. That's a busing company, and essentially Uber for long-haul trucks, respectively. We also have Gokada, Opay. There's been a lot of investment, a lot of activity in the sort of like taxi motorcycle space as well. So mobility, movement of people, movements of goods. That's as far as the consumer space. Then of course, that was sort of tech version 1.0. In the last 5 years, we've seen a lot of activity in that. Now we're seeing public listings. Interswitch that will list on the London Stock Exchange this year for about $1.5 billion. So we're seeing liquidity. In Egypt, they just had a fintech company list on their local stock exchange. Jumia, it listed on the New York Stock Exchange this year as well. So e-commerce, fintech, mobility, and the consumer side. And then because African economies were really built on traditional or extractive industries, agriculture, well, that's one, but energy, mining, oil and gas at large, a lot of these spaces that have sort of taken a hit as they're increasingly exposed to global competition and a lot of volatility, and particularly the energy and oil and gas space, we're seeing a lot of B2B enterprise solutions that promote transparency and efficiency in processes. So before there was, the oil and gas space was pretty, I don't want to say unregulated, but now with increasing global competition, people are very, very focused on processes that increase efficiency and actually HR management and workflow management. So that's what we're seeing as far as on the trends. And then as far as what investors can do to, I would say anything that would encourage the viability of the ecosystem at large, and that could be investing in initiatives that promote technical skills development and capacity building. So we have on the continent a lot of like very talented C-suite and technical skills at the top, and then sort of like bottom of the pyramid, like analysts and entry-level positions like that. But as companies are starting to scale, increasingly we're seeing a like missing middle of mid-level management and sort of mid-tier developers. So investing in capacity building initiatives that focus on technical skills development and sort of like operational or the more sort of like mid-level management skills. And then on the other side, just making ensuring that the ecosystem is viable by investing in companies, like doing your research, co-investing. If you're a foreign investor, co-investing with a local on the ground. Like we fortunately haven't had any crazy stories happen on the continent yet, or hopefully it never happens. But co-investing with locals, and then also being conscious of valuations. As San Francisco has gotten more involved in investing on the continent, we're seeing a lot of inflated valuations, which isn't necessarily a great thing for the long-term viability of the companies. So being very conscious of how you're spending the money and working very closely on diligence and investing with local partners. I think those are two
things.
Ways, yes.
Jonathan, can you talk about some ways in which we can help young women get greater access to the internet and the importance of that?
Yeah, I'd love to, because I think one of the things that's interesting about all the investment that's happening is that unless you are being intentional about applying a gender lens, unless you are being intentional about closing the digital divide, it's not as if that happens automatically. Mm-hmm. The evidence for policy design team at Harvard did this research in South Asia looking at different levels of access to mobile technology, and they found that the gender gap in digital access persists across different income and earning levels. The problems are social. They're not necessarily about the infrastructure or a lack of investment or a lack of investment smarts. So what's required, I think, are really smart partnerships, because the problem needs to be addressed in a fairly holistic fashion, and making that concerted effort to recognize that girls and women are this enormous opportunity. Over the last 2 years, over the last 3 years, the number of girls and women coming online has doubled. That's set to double again in the near future. We need to be ready to meet girls and women as they come online for the first time with services, with products that meet their needs. So we need to be sure that we're providing something relevant to them, something that's empowering. With KaiOS, we're using the KaiOS Life app to make sure that our potentially life-saving content is available to girls through the devices that they have access to. Mm-hmm. And so we're being very conscious about recognizing what the obstacles are that are preventing girls and women from accessing what they need, from achieving their potential, but also what the opportunities are that already exist that we could be taking advantage of if we just made smarter choices.
Mm-hmm. And connected to that, how connected is commitment to girls' education to them also getting access to the internet? Do you see a relationship between those two? That is, girls being in school is actually connected to then also having access to the internet?
Yeah, well, I think that they're all interrelated. At the moment, parents, mm-hmm. not just in the countries that we work in Africa and in Asia, but parents everywhere are nervous about what their teenage daughters are doing online.
And their boys.
Yeah, but and the boys, exactly. And so what we're trying to do is to show parents and communities that girls are not just going online to message their friends or going onto social media. They're going online to access information that they desperately need that improves their education.
Yeah.
So we take an approach that is cognizant of the fact that girls aren't the only decision makers in the household. They're not the only ones who decide when and how they get access to mobile phones. We need to be communicating to parents what the value is of those devices. And that's where our partnership with Vodafone Foundation is so important, because they are, through their own marketing material, and by supporting us and making some of our services free to access, so there are no data charges, they're saying to their consumers, hey, there's this whole raft of services, there's this whole incredible range of things that girls can be doing if they get access to a mobile device. And that's part of building a larger narrative of empowering girls.
Mm-hmm. So Sebastian, can you talk a little bit about the importance of providing people with a phone that can actually access the internet?
Yeah. Yes, actually there's a challenge in that. We observe we deploy a lot of products in different countries. We have a lot of users actually today in India. We start to have quite some users in Africa as well, in different continents and countries. What we observe is even though you provide an internet-capable device, even though you provide free data, for example, for a couple of months, some of our users, the first thing they do is they stop the data. Mm-hmm. On the device, so there's actually a tendency to scare a little bit the access to internet. We observe that, and we see a need to really educate and to make this access to internet easier to understand and more relevant for all our users. So it's not only providing a device that has internet capability, it's also bringing the internet service in a modular way and in a way where people don't understand the benefit. So the work we do around the Life application, actually, on KaiOS, we have a store with application and internet, traditional internet services, and then we decided to isolate some of the service into an application which is called Life, which is all about gender equality, education, health, financial service, and so on. Things that are more relevant for our users, first-time internet users. And so all these services today, we are trying to bring them in a more accessible way and also in partnership with the operator so that they are zero-rated and actually people don't scare to use data when they start to use this type of services. So this is start to work. It need time. It need time to educate and to really bring all these services to life.
Okay. It looks like we have a couple of questions from the...
Before we get into that, I just wanted to add a little like context so people can understand. As far as like getting more people on the internet, the problem is that data is so expensive on the continent. I live in Nigeria. I pay more in my monthly data cost than I do for my entire cell phone bill in the U.S. And there's a big sort of Netflix competitor in Nigeria, and they have an office of 60 people. And I was talking to him about a sort of like OpEx, CapEx a couple years ago, and he was saying 1 month expenses of power and internet is $10,000 for an office of 60 people. It's so expensive to have a reliable internet on the continent. It's insane. And also the average in Nigeria, it's about $2.2 per gigabyte for data, and it ranges on the continent from, you know, the $1.50 in South Africa to upwards of $60 per gigabyte in some other nations. And it's like, if we want to really think about how we can, when the per capita GDPs are between $2,000 and $5,000 per year, we really need to think about like how can we just bring ISP and low-cost internet and connectivity to the masses first, before even thinking of like why people aren't using internet. I'm not using internet that much when I'm in Nigeria because it costs a lot of money.
It costs expensive.
But I think if you look at what's happening in India, though, KaiOS is available on Jio devices. Mm-hmm. And in a very short space of time, data used to be incredibly expensive. Mm-hmm. And now the price of data has reduced. And you see that many more people are coming online. There are tons of startups everywhere. Men are still 33% more likely to be using data services because of the norms that exist around it. So again, just emphasizing that it's a complicated problem. Mm-hmm. The data is critical to solve, yeah.
So there was, and we just have about a minute left, but I'll open this up to the entire panel, but there's a question about foreign, you know, can foreign aid have a negative, and I would say negative or positive effect in closing the digital divide in a continent like Africa? So whoever wants to take that, knowing that we have less than a minute left. In less than a minute.
Okay, so very, very quickly. Before I launched the fund, I was doing emerging market economic research. I lived and studied in Madagascar. My family's from Nigeria. I lived and worked and studied in Costa Rica. And I was observing Western nonprofits and their ability to implement sustainable missions in emerging markets. And I found that without local management and local ownership, none of the programs, in no program that I was working with, did I see a sustainable mission that actually long-term impacted and lasted in the lives of the local people. And that's also when you're thinking of building business or of economic and social change on the continent, really thinking through how do we promote local ownership? Because who understands the nuances and the complexities of the challenges than the people who actually live there?
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
Also, what better way to create a viable solution than something that makes money and can be sustained over time? Mm-hmm. And like also, lastly, what we also found was in economies with fast growing GDP growth rates, the standards of living of the populace at large increased as well. So if you can make creating jobs, and if you can make creating businesses easier, you will inherently improve the lives of the populace where you're working.
Wonderful. Well, we're gonna have to leave it there. Thank you so much to all of you.
Thanks.
And I'll follow you up.